Shri Dilip Shenoyji, who is heading the National Skill Development Council, which is a very, very important sector of the current government. Already huge schemes have been announced. So it's an honor to have Dilip ji here, and you can explain about how the minority organizations can interact with your organization. Sir.
Thank you, Ravi. Good evening, and thank you, Ms. Narayan and Ravi, for having me here. What I'd like to do in the next 5 to 7 minutes, I know we are running very late, so the next session is very important, is to actually lay before you what is happening in the skill development space and how minority institutions can actually take part in the whole skill efforts of the country. The first thing we've got to understand is that there are over 17 ministries that have over 70 schemes that are available to develop skills in different types of areas. Two of them, which will be of importance to you in a large scale, are the Ajivika Skills Program, which is for people below the poverty line and minorities in rural areas, where if anybody wants to join a skill development program with a registered training organization, then that is entirely funded by the Ajivika scheme. And one of the conditions is that after the training, at least 70% of the students should get a job. The second is a similar scheme in under the Ministry of Housing and Poverty Alleviation, which promotes skilling for people in urban areas that who can join the skill development programs and get employed. The other ministries which do the programs, there are many sectoral ministries in leather, in textiles, which are key areas where minorities actually work, in construction, and there are other areas for scheduled castes, scheduled tribes, and other other ministries. So the idea here is that if you actually are running a minority institution and you have students who wish to get skilled and qualify as a beneficiary in any one of these categories, either in the urban centers or in the rural centers, you can approach the ministry and become an approved training partner, or you can approach an already approved training partner and mobilize students for them. Now, what happens if you want to undertake training programs and you don't have the funds? That is, there are people who are willing to be beneficiaries under this scheme of, let's say, Ministry of Urban Development or Rural Development or any of the states which are there. How do you actually interact with them and what do you do? But before I come to that, I also want to mention that each of the states has a national, has a state level skill mission which integrates all the skill development efforts under the various departments in the state, whether it be the polytechnics, whether it be the ITIs, whether it be the schemes that are run by even the Ministry of Minority Affairs also funds some schemes, and all the ministry schemes they're trying to actually integrate. So if you like to connect with them, whichever state you are in, if you connect with the state skills chief executive officer, you can actually understand how to utilize that. Now, what I was talking about earlier was, supposing you really want to set up a state-of-art modern skill development center, that's where we come in, and we provide soft loans at 6% with 2 to 3 year moratoriums and 10-year repayment period for any institution or group of institutions that want to set up skill development centers that would actually train at least 50,000 people over 10 years. So you heard the Prime Minister, Shri Narendra Modi, talk about speed, scale, and sustainability. So therefore, we're looking at scale, at least 50,000 people over 10 years. We're looking at sustainability, that you need to actually be able to repay the low interest loan. And we're looking at speed, because as a nation, we have to skill at least 50 crore people by 2022. So this, in effect, is what was the past. Currently, in the recent budget, The Honorable Finance Minister has talked about the launching of a Skill India mission, and probably you will hear about more about this in the few days to come. They've also looked at developing special schemes for people who are weavers, welders, cobblers, carpenters, masons, and traditional artisans. And this is another area where the minority institutions can take a lead and make a change happen. The National Skill Development Corporation has actually approved the funding of nearly 150 training organizations. We have 139 recently. We had a board meeting in which we approved another 15 projects, so we have crossed 150. And the idea here is that all of these institutions have set up training centers in about 367 districts of the country. Some of these training centers actually fall in areas where the minorities are less than 25%. So in those districts or those states, the benefits that are available if you have a minority population over 25% are not applicable. And what we have actually talked about is that if you could connect with these training institutions, enroll your students in this training institution so they can get trained, and after they finish the skill development, they can actually get a job. A lot of people have said, how do we get these people enrolled because we don't have access to funds? The government has actually set up a National Skill Vocational Loan Program where any individual can approach a nationalized bank to get a loan for skills from 20,000 rupees to 1,50,000 rupees, and NSDC has also worked on a program from 5,000 rupees to 20,000 rupees and beyond. And that loan is unsecured. That means you need not give a guarantee for it, and a student can avail of it, and the repayment starts after a specified period when the training is over and it can be paid back. In the event that the student is unable to pay, there's no action taken against the student because the government has also set up a national first loss default guarantee fund, which was announced in this operationalization of which was announced in this budget. So you have a great opportunity here, and there are four things which are happening currently which you need to understand. I talked about all of these different ministries and different schemes. There had been a committee formed to harmonize the schemes, so we'll have the same rate across the same skill in different schemes. Second, the ability for people who learn a skill to transfer into the education framework was not available. And what we are trying, what Mr. Jaina actually mentioned, that he has introduced a skill as a fifth subject in the NIOS scheme, so that when the person passes out from school with a skill, he can also get a job if he does not want to actually go on to higher education. However, if he wants to do a higher education, the University Grants Commission is introducing a BA in vocational, a BWOC course, so he can actually go and take a degree there. The National Skills Qualification Framework was announced on the 27th of December last year. Under this, the credits that are available for skills or for other subjects can be accumulated. And you can, if you accumulate enough credits, you can get a BA equivalent degree or you can get a master's equivalent degree. The National Skills Qualification Framework has 10 levels, level 1 to 10. In just as a way of explanation, level 1 is class 9, level 2 is class 10, level 3 is class 11, level 4 is class 12. So if you've done a level 4 skill certification and you've got equivalent marks, you can do a bridge course, which soon, I'm sure, NIOS and IGNU will be determining. If you do the bridge course, you can get admission into the next level in the regular education stream. So this National Skills Qualification Framework is to bridge the two gaps. It has been operational. And over the past 9 to 10 months, there has been the National Skill Certification and Monetary Reward Scheme, under which people can join a training program which is accredited to the standards that are set by industry, and I'll come to that in a minute. And once they pass that course and get a certificate, they can get an average reward of 10,000 rupees. The scheme was for 1 million people, 10 lakh people from August of last year to September this year. We've already had 13 lakh enrollments, so the phase one of the scheme is over. But in this budget, another 435 crores has been given from October to March. So phase two of this scheme would be launched. So here is what minority institutions can do. If we want to do a training program to get students to benefit from STAR, there are what Mr. Jaina explained to you, the National Sector Skill Councils. So one problem that education institutions had is they did not know what industry wanted. What are the standards that people, that industry is actually looking at? And organizations like NASSCOM are saying we can only employ 25% of the people that you can produce. So we have set up these different sector skill councils, 31 sector skill councils. They also cover areas like textiles, leather, gems and jewelry, automobile, retail, banking, oil and gas, power. There are 31 like that. And they have created the standards for 840 job roles. That means in their industry, and by 31st of March 2015, for 80% of the entry-level jobs in these 31 sectors, they have created standards. Any training institution that wants to train people for that particular job role in that industry can send their curriculum to the sector skill councils. They will tell you whether it meets the requirement or doesn't meet the requirement. And once it meets the requirement, they will offer to also certify your students and then help in placement of the students in that job role. So under the STAR scheme, which we call the National Skill Certification and Monetary Award Scheme, we branded as STAR, 16 sector skill councils had given 240 job roles, and all of these are eligible for participation in STAR. Going forward, we understand that according to the latest census, the initial target of 50 crores perhaps is not enough. If we look at the existing workforce participation rates in the country, we might have to take this to 64 crores. And if we want to achieve the average workforce participation rate of the world, which is 53.3, we would have to take this initiative to 86 crores. So the challenge is huge. The opportunities are varied and immense. You can log on, or you can actually work with any of the 70 national level programs, or the 29, actually currently 27 plus 2 to emerge state level programs. And you can also partner with organizations like NIOS or NSDC to actually transform the lives of millions of minorities in the country. So I just thought I'll share this with you, take more questions rather than give a speech from here. Thank you, Ravi, and thank you, Mr. Narayan, for this opportunity. Thank you.